Good evening, everyone. I'd like to call the Village of Midlothian special meeting for December 21st to order at 7 o'clock. Roll call.
Trustee Gillis.
Here.
Trustee Ivan.
Here.
Trustee Killily. Trustee Kreis.
Here.
Trustee LaRue.
Here.
Trustee Moskal.
Here.
Mayor Ryback.
Here.
You have a quorum.
Please stand for the pledge.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
At this time, I will open the floor to public comment. If you'd like to address the board, now would be your time.
Valerie Weiskirk. Good evening, everyone. It's kind of exciting. We're almost at the end of the year. And I actually have a very short list, so be impressed that I was able to condense it down to a nice little post-it note. But I wanted to go through a quick checklist of some things that have been outstanding. I was able to confirm that we do have the $80,000 available to be transferred. And Trustee Ivan, you did mention to me it will be discussed, correct, that it will be in the Finance
Yes.
Committee?
Yes.
Mayor Ryback, what plans do you have to go ahead and follow through on Sheriff Dart's request that the $88,000 be reimbursed to the general fund, if any?
We're taking it to the general fund with the money we have.
You're taking it from the general fund to the 2010A bond to restore the bond, but Dart's report said that the general fund needed to be reimbursed the $88,000 that was spent. So do we
have
that?
I'll have to review that request.
That's fine. That's fine. Next. At this time, it's my understanding we have no EMA director. Is that true? Okay. Next, is it true also at this time we do not have an ethics advisor?
It used to be our attorney, so I'm going to have to, I appreciate you bringing that to my attention. I'll have to make our attorney our ethics.
Great, because that's also out of compliance right now, and we're in violation because it's supposed to be within 30 days of the vacancy. Lastly, last year there were some questions surrounding the party for the Village employees. And I guess I'm looking for similar confirmation that I did receive last year. And I'm curious if this was a Village employee party that was held at Rite Aid Lodge, or if this was a personal party that did come out of your pocket. It wasn't taxpayer funds or anything.
Absolutely no taxpayer funds were used to pay for the party.
Okay, so it was of a personal party from you.
Correct.
Then for the record, I am beyond distressed because I have a copy of the invite, and the invite makes it very clear that you are supposed to RSVP to either the department heads or Mayor Ryback. Now, if I am to believe that it was a personal party, then you had no legal right to be able to say report to your department heads or to you, Mayor Ryback. You could have said RSV to Sharon Ryback. So from where I sit, I view this as you misappropriating government resources for your personal gain. That ties into the fact that according to the petitions that I have been reviewing, you use that party for your personal gain to go ahead and secure signatures on your petition. So once the ethics advisor is appointed, which I hope will be at the next board meeting, hopefully we'll finally be able to get some of these things resolved. And then lastly, I will certainly hope that, if not at the next meeting, perhaps at the beginning of the year, that the board will go ahead and call forth Evelyn Gleason to go ahead and give a full and complete accounting of her activities on the Midmark Water Commission board. And then also to have her bring to this board the entire and complete set of meeting minutes and agendas that she should have. And I certainly hope in next year we will be able to have whoever our appointed person is with the Midmark Water Commission on a regular basis reporting to the entire public what our appointed representative has been doing with that commission. So thank you.
Thank you. Is there anyone else?
I've got a couple questions, but I also had a statement to read, but I would like to do it when Don is here, if that's okay.
I'm not sure Don is actually showing up this evening, Kathy.
Oh, okay.
Because it's
that's
a couple
fine.
Days before Christmas.
Yeah, that's
Christmas.
Fine. Okay. Just a couple of questions with regards to a few of the agenda items. Under Karen Kreit, under Trustee Price's business, it says approval of amend IGA abandonment properties, and it lists a bunch of addresses here, but they're all on 147th Street. And I thought that some of the properties that were discussed last week were some of the properties on Pulaski, like the nail salon, the Honda dealer.
Yes, and what happened, there was one.
And they're not on here.
That's because those addresses are correct.
What is this? Oh, this is.
These are just to amend. Last week we approved 3640, 42, and 44.
Mm-hmm.
It should be 42, 44, and 46. That is just to correct that.
Okay. All right, got it. Okay, yeah, the statement here was kind of confusing, so I wasn't sure what the point, what the purpose of that was. The other thing is under the clerk's business, it says rezoning recommendations from the zoning board, Clifton Park and Waverly, ordinances to be approved at next week's meeting. What was being rezoned on Clifton Park and Waverly?
Mike, do you want to?
Clifton Park is a residential property that is currently zoned as office industrial. I'm sorry, that's the Waverly property. The one on Clifton Park is zoned as residential, and it was previously zoned as office industrial. Then an electrical contractor bought the property and was requesting it to have it rezoned to so he could put his electrical contracting business in where the old sheet metal shop was on Clifton Park.
So it's currently residential and he wants it to be zoned?
It was changed in 2007 to residential. He would like it changed back to office industrial so he can put up a garage and stores vehicles, his electrical vehicles in there.
Okay, and then that's Clifton Park. And the Waverly business again was?
Waverly business is a residence. It's been a residence for, I don't know, 40, 50 years.
But it's
zoned? Was zoned as office industrial.
And they want to change that to?
Residential.
Residential. Okay. All right, and then lastly, I have a statement to read. And this is with regards to the Loma. Okay. The role of the mayor and the board is to govern and make decisions for the greater good of the entire village, not just the select few property owners. And I urge the mayor and the board to reconsider the current Loma proposal and consider a compromise solution. A Loma on the commercial properties in the TOD area of town will result in an economic boost in the TOD area, which is for the greater good of the entire village. However, including the residential area in the Loma will benefit only those particular residents, which is not for the greater good of the entire village. And in fact, when those properties are removed from the floodplain, other properties in town will be added to the floodplain. So it's really not a gain for the village overall. It's a swap of one property out and one property in. And furthermore, what I've been told is that if a residential property owner is successful in removing their property from the floodplain, then that property owner may be entitled to a refund of their FEMA flood insurance premium for approximately 1 to 3 years worth of premium. So if a private residence is entitled to a premium refund, then why would the village spend public village funds on a Loma application for that particular resident? Would the village be entitled then to demand that that resident refund the village for the cost of the Loma on their property? I urge the mayor and the board to consider this compromise solution. Please revise the Loma boundary to include only those non-residential properties in the TOD area. And also, please redirect a portion of that $68,000 allocated for the Loma to begin working on CRS. The CRS will greatly benefit many more village property owners who do carry FEMA flood insurance, whether they do or don't flood. The CRS benefit will be a discount of flood insurance premium, which will also benefit village-owned properties as well. Please reconsider this.
Thank you. Would anyone else like to address the board?
I would like to ask you what, if anything, has been happening on the anti-littering ordinance that Midlothian may or may not have. Several months ago, I asked the board about that, and they said you would have to look into it.
I believe we have an anti-littering ordinance, and I believe community service officers are trying to do their best, trying to keep up with it.
Okay. Not quite what I was looking for.
Okay.
I pointed out that we don't have any signs in Midlothian as other communities do that says $50 fine for littering or from looking on the internet. I understand that in places in New York they even have a $250 fine for someone throwing a cigarette butt on the street because it's causing a lot of problems. Now last Friday here, they presented the 60% engineering for the Natalie Creek Fund, Now, these people are going to be spending a lot of money, and it's going to be very embarrassing to see what people in this village or surrounding villages throw into Natalie Creek. And I know because I personally picked it up this summer when we were working on our projects. So I think it's time not just to pass the buck and say, I believe this or that. I think it's time for a serious look at it. I think we need to show the people who are spending $8.3 million in this village to make things better for our residents that we can rise to the occasion and get something organized that is going to say, we appreciate what you're doing. And we need to start conducting a campaign in this village to create an awareness that this is not the right thing to do. And we're trying to do something to clean it up. And at this point, we need a committee. We need a trustee to take charge of it. We need a steering committee to publicize it and to create the awareness and to get something going, to discuss signage, to warn people about it. Do we have to live in the quagmire for the rest of our lives? I don't think so.
Okay. I appreciate your suggestions. We'll see what we can come up with. Thank you.
Well, how many more months will that take?
We'll try to move it quickly.
No, it's not good enough.
Well, I agree with you. I think we should have something in place before they start doing the construction in Natalie Creek. And I agree with you that our town doesn't have to be a mess, so I will push this very fast. I will see if I can get a trustee.
Can we get a commitment of 30 days for at least the initial step to be taken to know what the ordinance is?
Sure.
Okay, thank you.
You can hold me to it. Okay. Anyone else?
I do have a question. So again, last week I brought it up that we've been discussing the CRS issue for 3 years and 8 months, and I'm wondering, has anybody held a discussion in the last week? I'm just going to come every Wednesday, I'm going to ask, because you know there is an election coming and people should know that we've been asking for 3 years and 8 months. So if it's not important by now, they're going to know by the next election that it's not important then.
Yes.
Does the board have any comment about the shooting this morning in the town?
It's an ongoing investigation, and we have no comment at this time. Okay. With no further comment from the public, I will close the floor to public comment. I'm going to change the structure of how we're going through this. Trustee Ivan asked to go first this evening because we'd like to get the tax levy and the treasurer out here if we can. So, Trustee
Ivan. Thank you, Mayor. I think we might open up discussion. Is there any questions about the levy or the board on here? Any concerns?
I need you to ask for the approval of it.
Oh, first? All right.
Yeah. You can make the motion.
I want to make the motion to approve the tax levy for next year.
Any discussion?
I actually just would like to point some things out because I spent hours poring over this thing, and the way the levy is prepared this year is different. Correct, Treasurer Britton?
I'm sorry?
The way it is prepared this year is different than in prior years.
It is different from the previous year. That is correct.
And I just want to point out, make sure everybody understands this, because I did spend hours on this, and I did meet with Treasurer Britton about it yesterday, and I did speak to Trustee Musco about it, since he is our in-house CPA. Last year, we levied for all of the bonds. Correct, and then we abated a number of them. We abated the total amount of the 2007 bond, the 2008 bond, the 2009 bond, half of the 2010A bond. We did not abate the 2013. This year's levy, we are only levying for half of the 2010A and all of the 2013, correct?
Correct. However, if I could mention, we don't even have to levy for the bonds. We do not have to levy, because those are automatically levied by Cole County. They have all our ordinances. If we never put one levy on, one bond on our levy, they would still levy for them. We do have to abate if we want to abate. So this year, what I did was, this is that little cheat sheet that I give everybody. And last year, there was a little bit of, I don't want to say confusion, but the levy did not reflect this. The levy reflected the gross bonds, and that's what the levy reflected. And then, of course, we had an abatement ordinance. So after discussion last year, the levy this year shows only what we're going to levy after the abatement, so that this little cheat sheet, or the discussion sheet, could tie out to our levy. Again, we don't even have to levy for the bonds. Those will automatically be levied for. We do have to abate. But if we were not to levy for bonds, they would still end up on our tax bill. So we can go back to the way we did it before, if that makes sense. Or we can, or I can change my discussion sheet next year to show all the bonds, and then, you know, we can change things around, whatever is the board's preference.
But the reason we did it, though, was to provide more clarity from last year.
Well, so that there wouldn't be as many questions, because my discussion sheet shows everything after it's been abated, so that we could actually see the impact on the taxpayer and the impact on the levy. If it makes sense, if it's the board's wish to go ahead and show all the bonds on the levy, even though we don't have to levy because of the county, but if you would like to do that, I'd be more than happy next year with this discussion sheet to show them, and then show an abatement in the corner and maybe tie it out that way. We're just trying to be clear and make sure it's easy for everybody to understand.
And doesn't the this year's levy, isn't it less than last year's?
This year's levy is less than last year's. It is a negative 1% less than last year's.
0.1%
less than last year's. After we abate those bonds and levy for everything else.
I just wanted to bring that up, because if you look at last year's levy, it was 5.3 million without drilling down. If you just look at the totals, it was about, so 5.3 million versus this year of 4.484. So just in the spirit of full transparency, I just wanted to bring that up so that everybody's clear on this, because it was actually for me, it was confusing at first. It was. You got to drill down and look at those bonds and look in to see what was abated. So, and I appreciate your time yesterday. So I don't know if the board has any questions or any comments.
I have a couple of questions. Just on the general corporate, would be actually the third page. How do we get the $511,000 for historical society? Is that insurance for all properties or something? And the third page, 50-550.
That is, we could have put headers on every page, but that's the appropriation for 50-550. That's the appropriation, and then the that middle column is what is going to be paid for by just regular revenues or corporate revenues. There is nothing levied for that. That last column is what's
right.
going to be levied.
Well, what is that number, 511,000?
I don't have the budget in front of me, so
okay.
I would have to let you know.
The other one, and if you probably can cover the entrance for me, and Fire Department, 05-220. You still have a line item for POC fireman salary?
How much is it?
$7,500, is that callback for full-time guys?
Callback for part-time guys, or callback and girl time.
But again, that's just the appropriate, that's not the levy.
It's not even the budget, it's the appropriation.
Okay.
Not even the budget.
Any further questions?
John, we're talking about the appropriation ordinance. I mean, the levy.
Levy, yeah.
The levy.
So the EAB didn't change at all, huh?
You know what? Here's the thing, I don't know what the EAB is going to do, unfortunately. And so I left the EAB the same as last year. If you'll notice from this history, the EAB has gone down slightly every year. We're hoping that this year it might stay the same, or maybe we'll see a little bit of an increase.
Any further? I have a motion and a second. Roll call.
Trustee Iden?
Aye.
Trustee Moskal?
Aye.
Trustee Gillis?
Aye.
Trustee Philbin?
Present.
Trustee Kreis?
Aye.
Trustee LaRue?
Aye.
Motion carried.
Well, thank you, Maggie.
Thank you, ma'am.
And
and so we are going to, we all have the abatement ordinance now that we can review. That'll have to be passed in future meeting.
The abatement, yeah, for next week, if that's all right.
That's all?
That's it.
Okay, now we'll go back to Trustee Kreis.
Okay, the first item on the agenda, which there's a misspelling here, I did send it correct, the structured one proposal. I had sent the latest version, and I actually did it before I had the red line version, I read it. I sent it to everybody for review. I don't know if you're ready to discuss this yet. If you need more time, I know there's a lot to go through. So I'm just gonna open it up for discussion. I think as I read it, I do have, and it'll probably be comments for executive session, but I did have some comments and concerns under the lieutenant section. But I don't know if anybody else has had time to really read it and digest it, and if you're ready to discuss it or you want another week. But I did want to get it in everybody's hands. Fire Chief is here this evening. And I'm cautiously optimistic based on what I have read and based on a couple of the things that I see that I think are going to need to be addressed in this. That we may be able to move forward with this at some point and make a probably a counter proposal on this. So any comments?
So what's changed since the last time you brought this up?
What has changed?
Other than Dave allowed the sunset to bring it back in.
The sunset is back in, and going back to, and then I'll let the chief jump in after I. This whole thing with the points is gone. It's going to be based on interviews with, well, the education and training requirements under each position and the interview with the fire chief.
I have, just so our board members know, I have sent this to Todd Hayden and he is reviewing it. He has not gotten back to myself or chief. But he did say there were certain things, certain wordings in there that changed. I know that when we first sent it, it was the way we wanted it, and then we gave it to their attorney, and they sent it back with more red than I've ever seen on one piece of paper. And so now they've pulled back on that, and we just want to make sure it's closer to what we discussed. So I would recommend that maybe we hold until we hear from Todd, and then we can have an executive session over this so we can iron out any bugs we have with it.
I have a couple of comments I just would like to share. First of all, I know that this is a major restructuring for our fire departments since we've gone full-time. We've never had paid officers before. They're all volunteer officers. But I think part of the step we're missing here is we don't have any deputy chiefs. So I think we're doing things, in my opinion, a little backwards. We shouldn't be worried about the structure rank right now. We should be worried about our management staff, which we don't have. To my knowledge, we don't have a training officer. We don't have an EMS coordinator that is being supervised by a management staff. Well, they talked about not being able to do evaluations because we don't have officers and staff. Well, we don't have enough Indians right now, or enough chiefs for the Indians. I think that we're looking at the ranks, doing the paid rank staff, but what about the deputy chiefs?
I think I'm going to defer to Chief Hotwagner, and I have had this discussion.
Yeah, well, the biggest thing, Jerry, as you know, is we used to have three deputy chiefs. We're all in the union, and we're management personnel. But with recent changes and stuff going on with deputy chiefs, there's really no one who wants to step up in that position. to have no contract, to have nothing, to not have anywhere to go. So after we got into the negotiations, we talked to them back about the structure rank. And part of the deal with the structure rank is if we can bring people up through the rank, make it as lieutenants, from there move into a deputy chief position, which we're going to look to have one deputy chief, one captain, one lieutenant, and then three engineers. But the problem is if we just go ahead, like finally right now, we want to make three deputy chiefs, we're going to have to go outside because they're not going to take it. Because they're leaving a contract of what they have and benefits to the unknown. Because as unknown as a deputy chief here, we don't have any structure, we don't have a wage structure, we don't have anything that says you're getting benefits. Longevity has been an issue forever. Retiree insurance, nothing says you get it. There's nothing that says you get anything. So when we had guys step out, of course, as the older you get, it's easier because when you're close to retirement, you ain't gonna lose. But when you take a young person, like our last deputy that resigned, it's into the unknown. Okay, from there you have nowhere to go except out the door. Okay, so we're trying to get this structure rank back in for place first so someone could be a lieutenant. So if the deputy chief don't work out for their own reason or whatever, or they decide they don't want to continue, they can go back down as lieutenant. Right now they can't do this.
What would be wrong of having deputy chiefs and then we get the structure rank in, then they could be sworn in as a captain or a lieutenant, and that would cover them from not having that step backwards.
Well, again, that's the thing, getting them to do that, to step out, because they're leaving the union, and then what is the wages, what is the scale, are we going to take that back from them? Are we going to pay them, will we pay future, prior deputy chiefs?
How is the fire department different than the police department? Our deputy chief for the police department is in that same boat, and there's no fallback issue because we do have the ranks that he can fall into, and he's still subject to that. So I don't see why anybody wouldn't want to be promoted to a deputy chief. And knowing that the ranks are still there, I mean, as a board, I believe our responsibility is to have three management positions put in. That's what the contract verified in the union, and that's what the board, that's what I'm under the assumption that we have four management positions that should be filled in the fire department. That should be four and foremost before anything else. And if a firefighter, EMT, firefighter, paramedic doesn't want that position, it should be duly noted. And I'd like to see the names of the individuals that don't want to be promoted on the fire department, because then they don't belong here as far as I'm concerned.
Well, as you know, and you've had firsthand with the fire department, you know why there's deputy chiefs. Their deputy chiefs is nothing more than a glorified lieutenant. Nobody operates like Midlothian. Nobody has three deputy chiefs on a deputy chief for each shift, running a shift.
Only they have a deputy chief of administration, deputy chief of EMS.
Right, and they have a structured rank program that goes, we're reversed. We have three on the top end, we have our deputy chiefs, and we make them be line officers, and we say, oh yeah, and here's the management stuff we want you to do. Oh, and we want you to walk out of the contract into nothing. And that's the big hoop, but I mean, like I said, in the past, you know, I'm sure, like I said, we probably can get someone to do it, but it's gonna be the right people for the job. You know, sure, a young person with 2 years' experience would probably take it just for the money. But right now, the guys that are in there, sitting in there with a contract and have certain things are not willing to want to take a step out to the unknown without something.
You know, my recommendation for those positions would be not to replace the next three firefighters, advertise for a deputy chief, and bring three people in who are qualified to want the position. I mean, it's ridiculous that we don't have anybody that wants to fill that position.
Well, like I said, I can't say they don't want to do it. I mean, they may, but from what I've heard is that no one wants to go into the unknown, because once you leave that union, you come out into a man's position, you're not taken care of. It's just the history of...
Well, then I would like to see a formal recommendation of three deputy chiefs from the department in a letter addressed to them, and I'd like to see them address a letter declining that position, so we'll be on file.
I think, Jared, just from my short tenure in the fire department, I've been spending a lot of time back there trying to learn things, and I've never been in the fire service, so I certainly don't understand everything, but I've been trying to learn, and the intent was not to have three deputy chiefs. It was to have chief, one deputy chief, a captain, a lieutenant, and three engineers. And the captain would not be in the union, nor would the deputy chief. And that seems to be cost-effective, plus provide a management structure. And then if you want to become an engineer. There's a lieutenant, and then there's a captain. So I think it's a way to encourage firefighters to get the education that they need and the skills that they need to move up in a management position. And I guess logically you would think at some point then maybe the lieutenant or the captain would eventually, if the opportunity presented itself, be able to be promoted into a deputy chief position. Correct me if I'm wrong, Chief. I've spent a lot of time with you.
That's correct.
This.
And that's why the rest of the country has a structured rank. For some reason, we don't. We take you from a blue shirt, we hand you a white shirt, give you four bugles, say you're a chief officer, and you're nothing really more than a lieutenant, but we're giving you all that, whatever you want to call it, power, but we're asking you to go into the unknown and to take a job as a chief from a firefighter, which is unheard of. It's you know, we've been lucky to have people that have been smart enough in the past to take that job and work good with it, but we really need that structure. We need a firefighter to say, hey, you know what, I'm going to become an engineer. And hey, you know what, I'm going to take these extra classes, I'm going to be a lieutenant, and then a captain, just like every other fire department in the country. But we did it because we wanted three management positions, not in the union, is why it was done. And he knows the comments from a past chief will take one young person and make him a deputy chief just so he can be in charge. They had 2 years on the job. We can't go that direction. We need to have a structure like the police department has and everybody else. We need to go back to have that, because once we have the structure in place, then it's done. Then it's testing, then it's police and fire commission, and it's done over. Right now, we just go down the road picking who we want to pick. It's my pick, my recommendation to the board. I pick who I want. It could be a guy with 2 years, or a guy with 10 years, and say you're a deputy chief, change your shirt, now you're a boss. And then it happens is when you go out in the rig and you come up on the scene in other towns, they think you're a chief. Well, you're not a chief, you're really just a lieutenant. And it's just confusing. It's taking the whole structure of the way the fire department was designed and throws it away. That's why I've been trying to push for this. Prior chief before me tried pushing for it. I've been trying to get structured rank, because that's what we really need. You don't go from police officer to a deputy chief. You go to a captain, lieutenant, you go through the ranks. We need the same thing in the fire department. It just doesn't work that way anymore. And our track record shows.
Does the job responsibilities change between the lieutenant, the captain, and the deputy chief?
Yes.
So they get more and more responsibilities
yes.
as they move up.
But as a deputy chief from a blue shirt, you're getting everything. You're the boss of the crew, and you're the deputy chief, and you're in charge of the town. And by rank, a deputy chief is acts instead of the chief, so they have chief powers. So we have three guys with chief powers, so you have four chiefs.
So if you look at it, it's more of a training ladder on the way up to
right.
Deputy chief.
which makes more sense because you can slowly get into that position, not just get thrown in that position. One minute you're in the back seat, next minute you're in the front seat, and you're the boss and you're the man.
And I don't disagree with you because you know my feelings on that for the last 35 years. It's been a farce. Mm-hmm. We had that showed by individuals that were promoted and didn't have a clue what they were doing. And they didn't last long. But my comment on this is, as a board, are we willing to give up three management positions to make it one? That has never been discussed. And I think it should be discussed as a board with the chief, because just saying, okay, we're going to make one deputy chief. Well, there's a couple of questions come to mind. Okay, when that deputy chief's on 2448, will we rely on lieutenants to manage the fire scene in place of deputy chief or chief? I think we have to also discuss the fact about, you have always used the reign of having your deputy chiefs come back on their days off. Mm-hmm. Myself personally, I would like to see that just go away. Rely on automatic aid and the mutual aid that we give and get to get a officer in here without subjecting our employees to come back. I mean, they're working as a deputy chief or if we have captain's lieutenant, and they're getting paid for being in that position and the 24 hours they're here.
Right.
We don't pay them anything extra to come back, and I don't think that they should be obligated to come back.
Right.
That's another part that we do, but other departments don't.
Right, and the same thing, Jerry, is the reason why with the structure, right, once we get that place, we have those managers in place. We don't need those guys to come back, and quite frankly, we don't. The deputy chiefs used to live in town. Okay, the last chief, he had three deputy chiefs who all lived in Midlothian, who, if something's going on, he had three people that could take a car and respond to any calls. We're not going to have that, and in the future, it's going to get worse, as we see a lot of our firefighters are living farther and farther out of town, and even for your next chief. I mean, right now, we only got a couple guys that are there, they're still living down. So, by getting a structured rank, by putting those captains, lieutenants in charge, they're in charge of that ship for the day, and you know what, I'll be there when I can be there. And then if not, we'll rely on other towns like they do for us.
Right.
We have to get to that because that's just the way we're going. We're not going to have three deputy chiefs in Midlothian to respond to calls anymore. It's not going to happen. Or Oak Forest, you know, we had the one.
Well, isn't the lieutenant and the captain both the same as the deputy chief in that they're management or considered management?
Well, they're not considered managers. They're not managers. They're supervisors. So it'd be just kind of like the police department. You know, you got the deputy chief, the chief, deputy chief, then you got a lieutenant.
Sergeant.
Then you got your sergeants, then you got your detectives, then you got your police officers.
In the past, the sergeant, lieutenant, deputy chief weren't part of the police union.
Right.
Now we have the sergeants have their own union. In the fire department, the captain, the lieutenants will be in the union.
Not the captain.
The captain's going to be...
The captain?
Yeah, the captain will be out of the union.
Oh, that's correct. The captain will be in the union.
No, the captain will be out of the union.
No, that's right. That's right. That's what I thought the discussion was. The captain will be out of the union. Okay. Just the three inches.
That was kind of the deal we got with them, is to get the captain as a manager, Give them the lieutenant, and then make the three engineers and get rid of out of Class B. So no one gets out of Class B anymore. Right. The engineers will step up when the captain or lieutenant or deputy chief is off. They will move and run shift.
So... We're going to have how many lieutenants?
One lieutenant, one captain, one deputy chief, and then the three engineers, which would be station two guys in charge.
Okay, but your process would be to take either a lieutenant or captain and eventually make that person a deputy chief.
Eventually, right, we want to move up that structure. And the same thing, ultimately the best way for this department to operate now is like towns around, say Elsa, Oak Forest, eventually get another 9-to-5 person, deputy chief on 9-to-5, have a captain, two lieutenants, three engineers, and then we can then we'd be that's the way we should be operating. Right. That would take care of all of our problems right now.
Well, can I ask you this? Is it possible to make a organizational chart specifying if you were to do that, having an administrative deputy chief versus a suppression EMS deputy chief, mm-hmm. have the responsibilities have the captains as you have it in your job description. So we're showing everything on a chart so we can look at it better than the red out, the white out paper. I mean, I would like to see something like that so it would specify whose job is what.
We have that right now. We have our organizational chart shows that right now. Right now, it's just got the acting at class shift manager. When we had deputy chiefs, they were on top, and it shows everything that falls under them, EMS. We have that in place. It's just, it's just a matter of making the names and the titles right now.
Okay.
I think the structure might be the right thing to do for the fire department, absolutely. But I don't see anything much different than the version we just got, than the version we had before the board passed on.
It's other than, again, that the point thing is gone, and the sunset is back in. I mean, this mirrors what we thought we were moving ahead with back in. Gosh, we've got so many versions of this.
Well, there's still those are still under overseas instead of managed.
Yeah.
Other things that the board said, all right, we're going to pass this agreement, are still in there.
So. Right. Back from February.
Why do we think this is going to pass now?
Because the chief has worked with the union. I know that there have been discussions. And they agreed to this revised agreement, Gary. This is what their
attorney. It's a barely revised agreement.
Pardon me?
It's barely revised.
Exactly. There's a couple things again under the lieutenant that I had some issues with, but and if you look closely, you know, I think they're expecting us. The union is expecting us to come back and say we might need to tweak this a little bit. We'll probably have some input from our the village attorney as well.
The union clearly thinks it's going to pass quickly because they want to hold up performance evaluation because of this structure.
And I think we can get this through relatively quickly based on what the attorney, the union again. Remember, we had that whole thing that totally changed.
Yes.
And now we're back to almost what we had in February. So I think we can work.
I'll defer to attorneys. We're almost back to where we thought we were in the beginning.
I think the chief is cautiously optimistic as well.
There's definitely issues, I mean, that we had to discuss. But it is back to the original version. The other version had five more pages.
Right.
Of red that's gone. That was one of the throwing into the current contract and going through the labor board and all that stuff that we did, putting things in place. This one's tied into this contract for 3-year sunset.
Right.
So after 3 years, if everything's going good, then it would go into the 19 contract. That's the way it's worked. But like I said, the attorney really needs to look at it. I mean, we got it from attorney, we're none of us are attorneys, and like I said, I'm sure the board's gonna have a lot of questions on some stuff. All I did is bring it to you guys for the news.
As soon as I hear from Attorney Hayden, I'll get you guys the information he provides me with, and we'll go from there.
And again, I would encourage everybody, and Gary, you probably knew this better than anybody, because you were back in the fire department, way back in February, when all this was going on. But a lot of this is just wordsmithing, if you look. Words like, instead of member, it says bargaining unit employee, and there's may has been changed to shall. So a lot of it is just some wordsmithing, okay? All right, so again, I would encourage everybody to read it, understand it, get your questions. So hopefully we can move forward on this when we get some input from the village attorney. Sound fair?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Okay. Firefighter paramedic Juan Ramirez will be returning to work on Christmas Day. He's been off for how many months? 6 months?
Since April.
And it was not a work-related injury.
Right.
So, but he's, I think, very anxious to come back because every time I'm in the fire department, he's back. I don't know why the approval of invoice to Firehouse Software is on here because the board approved that invoice 2 weeks ago. Mm. I didn't submit that.
No, you didn't.
Under community development, as long as I have it on here, I would just like to make a motion to amend the IGA, Exhibit A to the IGA to just make a correction from 3640, 3642, and 3644 West 147th Street to 3642, 3644, and 3646 West 147th Street.
Second.
Any discussion? Roll call.
Trustee Kreisch?
Aye.
Trustee Ivan?
Aye.
Trustee Gillis?
Aye.
Trustee Killily?
Aye.
Trustee LaRue?
Aye.
Trustee Moskal?
Aye.
Motion carried.
And just as a follow-up to that, I attended the, and represented by proxy, executive, because he's on the executive board, John Killily, at the South Suburban Land Bank meeting on Monday, and it was really a great meeting. They're just doing incredible, incredible work. Donna, I have all the documents for you. And Attorney Brent Denson was there, and they're already working on ordering title on all of the properties that we have approved so that they can start the process as far as once they get the title report, the appropriate notifications. So keep your fingers crossed that they're successful in some of these properties because a number of them are in our downtown area, and because of the back taxes, nobody will touch them, and they're just very difficult to deal with. So let's hope that we have some success. Again, the work that is done by that land bank is nothing short of amazing. And I think Don can, it is beyond amazing. And we are very, very fortunate to be a member of South Suburban. The next item I have, received this email on Friday, December 16th. Dear Karen Price, we are pleased to advise you that the Board of Directors of the National Fish and Wildlife Foundation has approved $150,440 for the Midlothian Village Greenway Project, pending successful completion of our fiscal review process. This project is provided on the condition that these funds will be matched by $171,200 in matching contributions raised by the Village of Midlothian. Haven Whipple will be generating a grant agreement and will contact you with any questions. The board and staff of the National Fish and Wildlife Foundation wish you the best of luck with your project. Sincerely, the National Fish and Wildlife Foundation. This is the Shykale Rivers Fund grant that the village applied for to complete the project south of the VFW. The match, part of the match is the land contribution, which was valued at $100,000, and part of the other match was the Illinois Green Infrastructure Grant, and I'm still working on putting that documentation together to get to Springfield. Received another email from them today. They need additional, they need some additional documentation. So we have more funding to complete that project. It will probably have to be tweaked a little bit because so much work was done by volunteers. But again, I am so proud that we prepare these grants. I had help on this one, again, from partners. But we are recognized. I actually received a congratulatory message from Reggie Greenwood at South Suburban Mayors and Managers. But it is getting exceedingly difficult for me to manage all of these grants because it's great that we get them, but somebody's got to do all the paperwork, and it's me. So we do have another over $150,000, and again, we have to go through all of the paperwork process, but stay tuned.
And what is this money going to be used for?
Project. We still have about $50,000 from the Illinois Green Infrastructure Grant, and that's the paperwork that was the grant that was stopped. The state didn't have capital budget. They pulled all the funding. We have to have a new agreement. Now, I've been working on that. But again, it's really hard because I've got so many grants that I do myself. So I had a little bit of help from Maggie, but it's just an incredible amount of work because so many of them have all these reporting requirements, so.
Can I ask you a question?
Yes.
So you're saying that the value of the property was $100,000, the green infrastructure grant was $50,000, we need to come up with.
We have open lands is $10,000, volunteers, we came up with it. We've got the match covered. We had to identify the match when we submitted the grant. And again, your goal always is to have a higher match than the amount of grant that you're applying for. So we've gotten really good at coming up with match. And again, a lot of our matches are wonderful volunteers that, and this all works into our Midlothian group when we write these grants that we do. And you know, we pretty much.
So do we get to participate in the planning on what's gonna go over there since we did all the work over there?
Well, I think we are gonna need some community involvement because it's always part of it, and that is was gonna be one of my suggestions when we sit down, because the actual footprint of what will be done has changed since we submitted the grant because so much work has been done. I think we submitted this in April or May. So a lot has changed. So but we'll figure it out. I think we can do some great work over there. There's still a whole lot of work I think that can be done, especially along the creek. And we still have to get the parking lot in.
So, but it's not this grant that's gonna do the parking lot, it's the other $50,000 grant. Part of it can come out of this. Okay.
Because I don't think that grant, I don't think what we have left on the Illinois green infrastructure is gonna pay
enough
for the permeable surface.
Okay.
It's just not enough. We gotta go out to bid on that again.
So we can use some of this for that permeable surface. Mm-hmm. Okay.
Okay, but stay tuned. I'm sure I'm gonna get all kinds of documents that are gonna have to be filled out because they don't give you money without giving you a lot of paperwork. And the last, or the other item I have is I sent everybody the survey for the kind of over the VFW lot. And George Doe brought it to my attention. The last survey that was sent actually wasn't correct, but the surveyor did. There were 6 spots to the back of the building. This now shows 4 spots, which is 21.5 feet behind the building. It was not correct. I don't think it showed the 10 feet from that they would obtain south of the building. So I think this, and I'm gonna give this to George, I'm gonna email it to George so he can look at it again. But the way this looks right now, if they take 10 feet, the VFW, if we do the swap, 10 feet on the south, 21.5 feet behind the building, the VFW gives up 2,185 square feet and they pick up 2,090, that's on it. They have a net loss of 95 square feet. If they were to pick up 10.8 feet on the south side, it would be an even swap. So I don't know if we want to keep it 10 feet and see if they go along with that, or we want to be more precise, 10.8. I will have that discussion with George. Does that sound fair? Okay, anybody else have any comments on this? I'm going to send this to George then, and okay. And the only other thing I have, Mayor, I would like to go into executive session to discuss possible discipline. Okay.
Trustee Gillis.
You're all there with your parents?
Yes.
Yes, Mayor. A couple things. I had mentioned that we do have a probationary police officer that we're going to swear in next week, Zachary Blanchard. He actually obviously has passed all required pre-employment protocols and testing, so that will be on the agenda. With that, I have just want to bring the board's attention so that they're aware of it. We now will need to update our police department list that consists of the lateral transfer list, the lieutenant's list, the sergeant's list, and the police candidate list. The lieutenant, sergeants, and police all expire at the end of December. The lateral transfer list, according to Chief Coffin, is we've gone through all the names on that one. So he will address the fire police commission to get him going on this, because I believe that sergeant list have one name on, lieutenants list have one name on, so they'll have to do testing for all the procedure to get that active, so we do have those up to date. We can pass this now, please, Carl. This is, I had talked about the tax meter that we need to replace, just to update everybody. State police in the past have come in and certified and completed maintenance for our breathalyzer and tax meter in the past. They've been doing this for quite a few years, I believe since the early 80s. The state has determined that they're not going to do this any longer, so that leaves us with a machine that actually is going to be hard to get parts, and it is extremely old. So the best form of taking an approach that we would not like to take our officer to another department to have the taximeter utilized from somebody else. We'd like to continue to do it in-house. So with that, Chief Kaufman looked for prices for the best available meter. With that, he found the lieutenant worked on this, finding the best price through the state purchasing inventory for equipment. The price on this, I believe, is just under $7,000. I'll be looking to get that approved next week, or we can, at the special meeting, so we did discuss it somewhat last week. So I would like to make a motion to approve the purchase of this taximeter, not to exceed the price of $7,000.
I'll second that.
Any discussion?
Yeah, we didn't have this in the budget, though, did we?
We have, and I believe it may say it on there, that I only talked to Chief Kaufman, we do have DUI funds from DUI, so it can be taken out of there. And we also have a DUI line item for
expenditures.
Yes.
Yes.
Okay.
So initially it wasn't in the budget, but it can be. It can come
Chief,
out of budget.
Chief assured me that he covered it between the funds
yes.
from DUIs and the line items.
Yes.
Okay.
And then down the road, what we'll probably have to do is send somebody for training for maintenance, because we'll have to have that complete. And this company does supply training. I believe the cost is $750. There's a class in February of 2017 in St. Louis is the closest location. So we may look to get somebody into that, and that would come out of our training budget.
Any further discussion? I have a motion and a second. Roll call.
Trustee
Gillis.
Aye. Trustee
Moskal. Aye.
Trustee Ivan.
Aye.
Trustee Killily.
Aye.
Trustee Kreis.
Aye.
Trustee LaRue.
Aye.
Motion carried.
Just to give the board an update on the information that Chief Hoffman got from the state's attorney's office, they are trying to implement a new policy change. Currently, when we arrest an individual for theft, if it is over $300, it is considered a felony. And if it's their first offense, it still would be a felony. The state's attorney's office put out a memo to change policy for theft, meaning that they want it to be over $1,000 for a felony. And not prosecuted as a felony until their 10th conviction versus the first conviction. So the police chiefs in the area are very upset about this. This could be very detrimental to small businesses, because this person could come back and keep stealing, or individuals can do that without being charged for a felony. So The chief has a meeting tomorrow with the chief association. They invited the state's attorney down. I don't believe she is going to attend, but they are looking to approach this more diplomatic because of the consequences that it would cost a small community like ourselves. So that's just for information, and I'm sure we'll hear more from the chief after tomorrow. And I just want to remind everybody that we do have a special enforcement that's going on right now. Drive sober, get pulled over. The local departments, including Midlothian, are working with state police currently. This program's going to run through the first of the year. They will have roadside checks. There's going to be a lot of activity, not just in our town, but other towns working with the state police. So it's apparent that obviously we want to encourage everybody in our village not to drink and drive or be under the influence of drugs. The sergeant almost sent the messenger that he would hope that people make arrangements to have a sober driver before they attend parties and go out. And this program is not costing the taxpayers any money. It's coming out of the Illinois Department of Transportation funds to pay for this. We're all over time that our officers are encouraged to take part in this program. That's about it. Oh, I do want to say publicly that I'm very happy we have compassionate police officers because my two daughters got out today and they got arrested down a block. And because they're very big and they are Rottweilers, I'm very afraid that somebody would have shot them if they didn't know who they were. So Officer Pace is my hero. So.
I hope they're grounded.
I thought you said daughters.
So did I. Thought you said daughters, too. I was like,
I could have sworn you said daughters.
My daughters are not dogs. So.
How
did they get out?
Well, on my back porch, I have a back door and a entrance door. My son, going out, didn't shut the door all the way, and the wind blew it open, and next thing I know, they're playing in the yard. I look out the window, and they're playing down the street by the creek, so scared the living crap out of me.
So one just followed the other.
Yes. Jim says the instigator, but he just goes one for the ride. That's all I have. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Trustee LaRue?
Yes, ma'am. I have on the agenda the discussion of the revisions to the performance management policy, the performance evaluation policy. I sent everyone Donna, HR consultant Donna Maslin's comments and summary. And maybe we can still discuss. I just think I have heard some feedback from a couple of trustees. I think maybe it's time just to sit down with Donna and the union reps at one table and to try to figure out what's happening here. We have, you know, one department could care less, one department says absolutely not. I mean, it's even though the contract says the village has a right to evaluate employees, I think we're running into, we're spinning our wheels, costing money to try to go back and forth. So if that's okay with you guys, I'd just rather table a discussion tonight and try to figure something out with a group of the union reps and even the department heads.
I think it's an excellent idea.
So that's all I have.
Okay, thank you. Trustee Killily?
Nothing planned.
Trustee Maskell?
I have nothing planned.
Okay. Under my business, because I wasn't sure he was going to make it. Actually, Kathy read a statement while you were not here because I told her I didn't know if you were going to come or not. Maybe she can provide you with a copy of it so you can read it. It's her concerns about the LOA. Under my business, I'd be looking for the approval of the award of the 2015-16 MFT CDBG Street Resurfacing Program to Deconstruction in the amount of $923,630.61.
I'll make the motion.
I'll second.
Any discussion? Roll call.
Trustee Gillis?
Aye.
Trustee LaRue?
Aye.
Trustee Ivan?
Aye.
Trustee Killily?
Aye.
Trustee Price?
Aye.
Trustee Maskell?
Aye.
Motion carried.
And I just wanted to remind the board that I am looking for your colored choices and how you want the wording to be. I received an email from the painting part of the water tower, and they would like to have it in the beginning of January if possible. So, and if you're thinking about white, do yourself a favor. I went, it was on Kedzie Avenue when I went past Markham. They've got a white one. The whole underbelly is riddled with black.
Well, Trustee Joseph has volunteered to clean it out.
Okay, I'm sorry. It's all taken care of. It can go white.
I thought you all did to take pictures of all the local water towers.
That's what it was.
Actually, I do have some of you guys.
So you got a little bit of time, but not much, so we can, you know, try to stay on it and get me what we want for it. If you want pictures, send me pictures of it, whatever, that's fine.
You had mentioned about color on the bottom. I just want to say, because I had the luxury of driving my wife to work in New Lenox, Manhattan, Mokina, Orland, and visualize a lot of water towers. The white ones, strictly white, there's some of them that look really good. Other ones, like Orland, has a blue base going up a little bit above, below the circumference. Mokina, the Crete, excuse me, has one that is actually all blue to half of the top. And it really hides the mold and the grime that comes about it. And the white ones that are out there, I mean, it's very visual to see it, so.
Yeah. Okay.
Well, can we pick out a nice color? Because this, my husband pointed out to me yesterday, and I didn't notice this, but I have a very clear view of the water tower from our master bedroom.
And that would be all I have this evening under clerk's business.
All the trustees that gave them copies of the rezoning ordinances from that I received from Dave with regards to the properties on Clifton Park and Waverly for rezoning from the zoning board and the recommendation from the zoning board to approve it. I just wanted to go forward with preparing the ordinances. If there are any questions or comments about it?
I would just like to make mention, because I'm very familiar with the property on 143rd
and Clifton Park.
Park, yes. If the owner did the work, or the previous owner did the work, it looks fantastic now. I mean, for the park district cutting the grass that is just west of that for years, the sheet metal guy was really laid back, and a lot of times that property was vandalized, spray painted over, everything. Now they have a fence completely around it. All the shrubbery's been moved, the village been painted. It looks fantastic. My first thought was, that is the only piece of industrial property in that whole back area. And I can see why that it would be changed to back to residential, because it's isolated. But as it sits isolated, it's also next to this big billboard that's, you know, way up near. So it sort of fits where it's at with the industrial down Waverly. So I'm glad that they have upgraded it before we even changed it. So
he's going to plant some bushes or something as a buffer between the house that's just south of him and his property. Also with a little bit more, you know, ambiance for the resident that lives there.
And then the other piece of property, like you said, it's been a house forever.
Yeah.
Knowing the people who lived in there, I guess he wants to rent it out to somebody now. So
he tried selling it to the ones that were living there, and the loan wouldn't go through because it's non-conforming.
Yeah.
All right, so I'll put those on the agenda for next week. Okay. As a reminder, mm-hmm. trustees, I need your information for next week's agenda tomorrow. So if you have something you need on the agenda, I'd like to try to keep next week's agenda between the holidays short if we can.
And
just as a, why not?
Can you stop working?
We are going to go to executive session when I get the motion, but I personally, as mayor and for the Board of Trustees, would like to wish each and every one of you a very Merry Christmas. And if you don't come back next week, a Happy New Year. And I'd be looking for a motion to go into executive session to discuss the discipline of certain employees.
I'll make the motion.
I'll second it.
Roll call.
Trustee Kreis?
Aye.
Trustee Ivan?
Aye.
Trustee Gillis?
Aye.
Trustee Tillely?
Aye.
Trustee LaRue?
Aye.
Trustee Moskow?
Aye.
Motion carried.
There will be no further business.